Hello, hello, guys, and welcome here to New York in the good old United States of America. If you guys have been following us for a long time, or if you've caught up on our old videos, you've probably seen this place before. This is my parents' home, the home where I grew up, and I made a vlog here last year. But today we're going to be doing a Q&A, an individual Q&A. And before we get into the questions, I'm going to give you a quick update on what's been happening since Sumatra and talk a little bit about where I am and where Shane is and what we've been up to. And then we'll get into all the questions. So, so right now I'm in New York. Today's date is January 9th, 2024. After we finished Sumatra, we took some time off in Bali, and that was around mid-November. So we finished Sumatra around mid-November. We flew from Banda Aceh to Bali. We shipped our motorbikes. We didn't drive back, and then we had a few weeks off. And then I flew back here to New York early or mid-December. So I've been here in New York now for 4 weeks. Now, Shane, he's originally from North Carolina, but he also has some family in Hawaii, so he flew back to Hawaii. So that's where he is. So we're not here together in the U.S. during this time off. But I've been here for the last four weeks now in New York, seeing my family and friends, celebrating Christmas with my family and friends. A lot of people ask us if we were going home for Christmas. So yeah, it's been nice to be here for Christmas. It's a good time of year. It's a good time to see people. People are in high spirits. So that's been nice. And I'm actually flying back to Bali tomorrow, the 10th of January. And then Shane will come meet me in Bali a couple weeks later, and then we're going to get on with 2024 and getting our year on with making content. So that's a quick update on what's been going on since Sumatra. And just briefly, while we're doing these individual Q&As is because, you know, we always do the live streams with both of us, but we figured, you know, we try to do our best to be respectful of each other and let each other answer questions. But we figured if we did them individually, you guys can ask us a lot more questions and we can each answer more personal questions and kind of give you guys a little bit more info if you're interested. So that's why we're doing these individual Q&As. And I've got a lot of questions here. I've got over 30 questions that you guys submitted on Instagram and also on YouTube on our post that we put up. But before we do that, I'm just gonna give you a quick background on who I am and how I got to Indonesia, because a lot of people asked about Shane and I, where we're from, and our life story. So I'll give you a quick one because we have answered some of this stuff in our old live stream. So if you're looking for more info about our backgrounds, go check out our first couple live streams. But so my name is Rob. I am 31 years old. I'm originally here from Long Island in New York. I'm from the suburbs outside of New York City. So for Indonesians that don't know the term suburbs, it's kind of like the neighborhoods that surround a city. So from my house to the city is about 30, 35 kilometers, and it's not that long of a train ride, maybe 30, 40 minutes. I grew up here until I was 18 years old. And then when I was 18, I went to university. Instead of going to a normal university, I decided to go to a military academy, which I believe Indonesia has as well. But I went to the United States Coast Guard Academy, which was a normal four-year college. And there I got my bachelor's degree. And then because the university was paid for by the military, I had a five-year contract that I had to serve when I got out. So I graduated at 22, and then I had a five-year contract with the U.S. Coast Guard. Then during that time, I was stationed in different places. I was stationed in California for a bit, and then I was stationed in Florida on the East Coast for a bit. And then when I was 27, my contract was finished. And I always had dreams of traveling. I actually had always had dreams of taking a gap year and trying to do some traveling around the world. So up until that time, I was saving a lot of money and focused on doing that when my contract was finished. So in July of 2019, I took off on a gap year traveling. So I spent 3 months in Europe during that summer. After that, I stopped back to US for a couple weeks. And then I spent November in Australia. Then I spent December in New Zealand, most of the time in a van camping, which was really fun. And then after New Zealand in January of 2020, I flew to Thailand. And my hopes were that I was going to travel around Southeast Asia for 6-7 months. Obviously, in March 2020, a lot of things changed with COVID. But during that time, I was making my way around the peninsula of Southeast Asia. I had done Thailand, Laos, and Vietnam. And then when I was in Vietnam is when things really started to go downhill with Corona. And it's kind of a long story, but eventually I ended up taking a chance and booking a flight to Bali from Da Nang in Vietnam. And that was on the 17th of March, I believe, in 2020. I flew to Bali. I had some friends there through my travels. And then 2 days later, The whole entire world shut down. So the whole entire world shut down. Indonesia closed its borders, and most other countries closed its borders. And then I ended up staying in Bali for quite a long time. But yes, there I met Shane a couple months after I had got to Bali. He had also been there and had different plans and different plans for his future and his travels. But yeah, eventually we had met in May of 2020, became friends, started traveling, and we started the Lost Boys channel in September of 2021. And yeah, there's a little bit more information about why we started and how that happened, but I'll save that for later, or if you guys want to check out the first live stream. So yeah, that's a little bit of a brief story about me and why I got to Indonesia. So a lot of people ask, you know, did you choose Indonesia, and why did you choose Indonesia? And in a way, it's like, I did choose Indonesia, but in a way also Indonesia kind of chose me and chose us, because we got stuck there and we couldn't leave during Corona. And it worked out so well, because personally, I could say that I've fallen in love with the country, and although I thought I'd go home maybe in later 2020 or even 2021, I never went home. And eventually we started the channel, and now we're here today, which is pretty wild. So, but that's the brief story on me and how I got to Indonesia. And then I know a lot of people asked about Sumatra. Before these videos will come out, we'll probably have a live stream that Shane and I have done talking about Sumatra. But just to tell you about my feelings towards it, it was a really long trip. It was a really crazy trip. I think we were on the road for in total around seven and a half to 8 months. So it was a really long time on the road. I'll say we didn't expect to be on the road that long. I think we may have underestimated the island underestimated how big it is, how underestimated how tough some of the traveling would be, and underestimated how long we would be there. But yeah, so we were a bit tired by the end. But it is what it is. I'm glad we finished. Our goal was to make it to Kilometer Nol, to make it to Sabang. So yeah, it was a really long and tough trip, and we learned a lot. And I'm sure there's a lot of questions towards the end about things we learned, and I'll try my best to get into that. And then overall, my feeling towards Sumatra as compared to other islands in Indonesia, because a lot of people have asked, is it's definitely felt different from the islands that I've been to. So it's definitely felt different than Java, Bali, Lombok, Sumbawa, and Flores. And that being mostly because the people are very, very different. And I'm sure people that have been around Indonesia know, but most people in Sumatra, especially in West Sumatra and North Sumatra, they're a lot more outgoing, they're a lot more social. I think Indonesians say terbuka, they've got a lot more personality. So it's when you're traveling, it feels a little bit more aggressive. People are a lot more direct and on top of you and come straight up to you and come talking to you. I think the example I've given a million times to all my friends is like in Java, if someone wants, a lot of people ask to take pictures with foreigners, with bules, but sometimes they'll kind of like sneak a photo of you like from the background, or they'll come up to you and like, "Boleh minta pa? Can I have a photo?" But in Sumatra, it's very, very different. People just come up to you, they grab you, they pull their phone out, take a photo. So it's pretty funny, but it just feels a lot different. But overall, it was a good time and it was a good trip. I think we learned a lot. I think we grew a lot as people and as YouTubers and as content creators. And yeah, Shane and I, I'm sure we'll talk a little bit more about that, or have spoken about that during the live stream. So yeah, so that's been kind of what's been going on since Sumatra, and a little bit of an update. But I'm gonna go into some of the questions you guys have now, and we'll see how many we can do. And I've got them listed as some easier personal questions that you guys may have. I've got some questions about Indonesia. You guys have a lot of questions on favorite places and food and whatnot. And then I've got some more thoughtful, you know, serious questions at the end. So we're just gonna keep it real, we're gonna keep it raw, just sit down and have a chat and talk, and let's start. So the first question I have was on Instagram from Indri Miyoki. She's one of our loyal followers and subscribers. She asked, "What is something that people wouldn't guess about you?" I thought a lot about this when I saw this, but honestly, I think something that people wouldn't guess about me is that I really don't like attention, especially in real life. So I guess it's a little bit different, because when you post things on the internet, obviously you're garnering attention, but it's a little bit different than in real life. But I really don't like attention. Like especially in real life, when all the spotlights on you for some reason, you know, I hate birthday celebrations. When I've had like a few like birthday celebrations in the past, almost surprise dinners or whatnot, where there's 20 people and everyone's there for you and sing happy birthday for you. And I'm kind of honestly in some situations very shy when the spotlight's on me. So I think that's something that people wouldn't guess, because we have a YouTube channel and try to get people to watch our stuff and like and comment on it, which is kind of like seeking attention. But yeah, it's a, and through YouTube, I wouldn't say gaining attention is my number one priority. It's not at all. So it's just to make good videos and to grow a successful business. So yeah, that's something. Yeah, something that people wouldn't guess about me is that I actually do not like attention. So yeah, that was the first question. I'll go with the second question. Also on Instagram. And I'm apologizing if I butcher people's profile names and YouTube channel names, but this one's from Ciala.RTF asked, what is my zodiac sign? So my zodiac sign is Aries. I was born in April. I'm not going to give you guys the birth date. I don't know how somebody, I think, knew Shane's birth date one time and had commented on a video or a post of ours. And Shane and I were trying to figure out, I don't think we've ever given you our birthdays at all in the last two years. So I don't know how you guys, man, some people figure out some ways to find out info, but yeah, I don't know how you guys figured that out. But yeah, I'm an Aries and I was born in April. So that's my zodiac sign. If you think that indicates anything about me or my personality, then go right ahead. But all right. The next question, also from Instagram, Triana Wuland 07, what was your previous job and was it okay to leave it? So yes, like I said before, I was in the Coast Guard, which is a branch of the military. I don't know if Indonesia has a Coast Guard. Not all countries have a Coast Guard, but the best way I could describe it is it's similar to the Navy. There is a few different roles and responsibilities that the Coast Guard does that the Navy doesn't do, but overall I'd say that the Coast Guard is less of a war time service. It's more of law enforcement. The Coast Guard does a lot of law enforcement, and then the Coast Guard does a lot of search and rescue. So these are like the two biggest things that the Coast Guard does. And that was a mission that I was interested in participating in. So I worked on everything from big ships, like 100-meter ships that had around 150, 200 people on them, to small boats, more like, you know, 10-meter small boats that just have a few crew. And then the Coast Guard also has helicopters and planes, and I would mostly focus on the water, but I had, you know, experience working with all these different platforms. But yeah, so that was my job, and the Coast Guard is part of the military, so I was working in the military for 5 years, and then yes, I was allowed to leave because my contract was finished. So I just had a 5-year contract, and once my 5-year contract was finished, I decided to part ways. And then the next question, which goes along with that, also from Instagram, Anis Pripa 2, what are the ups and downs of being in the army or the military? Do you miss it? There's a lot of pros and cons to being in the military in the U.S. I think, especially in the U.S., I think the U.S. treats military people very, very well. From what I've heard in other countries, it's not exactly the same, but at least I could speak for the U.S. is there's a lot of really great benefits. The pay is quite good. Also, you have your health insurance covered. If you have a wife or children, they pay you more. They give you extra money for housing and food that's not taxed. If you stay in for, you know, 20 years, you get a pension. So there's a lot of really great benefits to being in the military that sets you up, you know, especially if you have a family, sets you up financially and give you a lot of stability and security. Some things that aren't so good is that your life, I mean, you don't have much freedom. You're pretty much controlled by the government. You change jobs or you change duty stations usually every 2 to 4 years, and you can put in a list of where you'd like to go, but you don't have much control over that. You know, you put in a list of 20 places and then they pick one, and sometimes it's not on your list. So every 2 to 4 years, they tell you where you're going to move and where you're going to live and what kind of job you have. So you don't have much freedom and much control over your life. And even if you want to travel outside the country, you have to get permission. So these are obviously, if you can see the way I've lived my life in the last couple of years, that's not something that I was, you know, really into. You know, I definitely appreciate a little bit more freedom. Freedom to travel, freedom to do what I want, freedom to live what I want, where I want, freedom to have what job I want. So yeah, those were kind of like the pros and cons for me for the military. And ultimately, I felt that I would rather have a life on the outside. So I have no regrets doing my 5 years. It set me up really well. I got a lot of really great work experience. I was an officer because I went to the academies. So I immediately stepped into like a manager position when I was 22. So I had a lot of good managerial experience as a leader and working with people and managing with people. And it set me up really well, especially with taking on running the YouTube channel with Shane. So I appreciate that. But you know, no regrets that I did it, but I'm happy that I did my contract and finished. I think if I would have done 20 years in the military, I wouldn't have been as happy as I am now. So that's just my personal opinion. So that's the question about the military. Next one is also from Instagram profile, Tasia MLLL. What does the perfect vacation look like? So for me, I think we've talked about it before in our some of our vlogs, but I definitely view a difference between a holiday or vacation and traveling. So I think those are two different things. So if we're just talking about a vacation, which I envision as kind of just time off relaxing, I would probably say, you know, beach vacation for sure. Maybe, and I wouldn't say a big hotel. I'd probably prefer some type of bungalow or, you know, like small house, like a beach house or a beach cottage on a nice remote island with not many people around. And maybe with a girlfriend, maybe with a significant other, and enjoy that. So that would be like the best vacation, perfect vacation for me. By the beach, secluded, not around a bunch of people, and somewhere kind of pretty. So that would be my perfect vacation. And then the next question, also from Instagram, nopella.a, where's the best place in the U.S. for a holiday? So I don't know how much the Indonesians know about the U.S., but it depends on what you're looking for. So the U.S., I will say one great thing about the U.S. is the diversity in geography, the diversity in nature, the diversity in the cities. So, you know, I meet a lot of people that come to the U.S. for a few months and they just go to a bunch of cities and I say, man, you miss all the national parks, like you miss all these beautiful places. So it depends what you're looking for. But if you're looking for a beach holiday, you could find it. I mean, you can go to Hawaii where Shane is right now. Get that island beach life. You can go to southern parts of Florida, which is beautiful tropical beaches. Or if you're looking to ski or snowboard, you can go into the mountains in Colorado. If you're looking to do some more adventurous type stuff, you can be in any of the national parks and, you know, in Utah or Arizona. So it really depends what you're looking for. I think the U.S. is really diverse and is a great place to explore. The only downside is that it's quite expensive. So I always tell people, if you are, you know, a world traveler and you're interested in traveling different parts of the world, I don't think it's a bad idea to leave the U.S. for later. You know, do it down the line, do it when you have a bit more money. I think there's better places you can go in your 20s and even your 30s while you're young and you know, on more of a budget and you're looking for a more a bit wild and crazy. And then, you know, later on in life, maybe get a van and travel to the U.S. and see some of the nature and visit some of the cities. So yeah, it depends. It depends what the best, you know, what your interests are. For what the best place would be in the U.S. for a holiday. Okay, the next one from Instagram, Alophilia. Where would you take people visiting your hometowns for the first time? So, I don't know, maybe you could watch our vlogs from last year, but and where I took you guys. But if you came to New York, if you came to Long Island, where I'm from, I'd probably take you to eat. As we probably all agree that food is so important. And I'd probably take you to get a slice of pizza, a slice of New York pizza, and I'd probably take you to get a bagel. So a bagel for breakfast, which you guys saw in my video last year, and then pizza for dinner. And then outside of that, I would probably just bring you to places where the people are. So I'd either bring you to a bar or a pub if you want to have a beer, or if I had, you know, a gathering with friends, if it was at my house or another house. I think the people where I'm from on Long Island in New York, I think they're special people. I think they're really good people. They're, you know, they're loud and they're crazy, kind of like me, and they have a lot to say, and they're really good storytellers. And maybe from the outside, they appear very aggressive, but they have such warm hearts, and it's something that I've appreciated being home these last few weeks. So if I brought someone here, I'd want them to kind of meet the people that raised me, meet the people I grew up with, and just kind of get like the spirit of what Long Island and what the community here is about. So that's what I would do if you guys came to my hometown here in Belmore. The name of my hometown is Belmore on Long Island. So if you want to look it up on Google Maps. But all right, let's go to the next one. Okay, one of Shane and I's favorite guys, Real Red and White, both on YouTube and Instagram. Shout out, brother. It's good to hear from you. He has a pretty loaded question, a pretty heavy question, quite political. But I'll try to keep it vague. We don't want to get too political here on this channel. Yeah, he asked What things do you feel the U.S. should keep having, add, and lessen post-election? So for the Indonesians that don't know, I know you guys have your presidential election in this year, and so does the U.S. So we are electing a new president. What would I say about the U.S.? What would I change, lessen? It's hard to say, man. I think the U.S., I'll be honest, is in a very tough spot. I think there's a quite a big divide in our country, unfortunately. I think a lot of that's been brought about by the news and the media. I think being dishonest when they report things, and I think it's created a lot of division, unfortunately. I don't know how exactly that works if Indonesia, or if you guys feel the same way, if you feel that there's a lot of misinformation on social media and on the news that kind of, maybe separates people rather than brings people together. So I guess in general, I would say that whoever is elected president, I hope they can get us in a direction that brings the country together. I think it's been over the last decade or so, I think we've been kind of growing apart, unfortunately. So yeah, I hope we can go in a direction of bringing the country back together. As for foreign policy and some other things and geopolitics, it's very, very complicated in terms of what we have our hand on. But I guess what I will say is that, and one of the lessons I've learned is that, when you're judging a people or you're judging a country, is that you have to understand that a government is not always an accurate representation of the people of that country. So, if you do have a problem with the American government, then just know that not all of American people agree with what the government is doing. Just like, if I had a problem with the Indonesian government, I understand that the Indonesian government doesn't represent everything in Indonesia. And the same goes for any country in the world. So, it's hard to say, what I do like and don't like that the government is doing, but in general, I'd say that I do feel a lot of division and tension in the U.S., and I hope things, whoever gets elected next can help bring us back together, because I do think the U.S. is a great country and has a great future ahead. So that would be my general feelings. Thanks, Red and White, and shout out for always leaving the best comments on YouTube on our videos. So we'll go to the next one here. From Instagram profile, Ria Punya, have you ever felt tired traveling and want to go back to the US for good? So, yes, definitely felt tired traveling towards the end of Sumatra for sure. And have I wanted to go back to the US for good? Right now, no, I don't have interest in coming back here. But I think, like I said in my videos last year, and my feelings are that I would never. I don't know if I'm going to stay in Indonesia forever, and I don't know if I'm ever going to come back to the US. I honestly don't know. But I can honestly say that there may be a time in the future that I want to come back to the US either permanently or maybe even spend a few months here out of the year. But I can say right now that that's not in my interest. I'd say for probably the next, my 5-year plan doesn't involve moving back to the US, at least as it stands right now. I spent 27 years here. I had a great time, made great friends, and got good work experience and had my family and friends, but I'm sure as you guys have seen from the channel, I'm just very interested in traveling and very interested in experiencing the world, and that's what I'd like to do. So, once I had the opportunity to leave at 27, I took it, and that's what I'm going to keep doing for the next few years, I think. And then, to be honest, another reason why I wouldn't move back to the US, at least at this point, is just because of how expensive it is. And it depends on where you are in the country. There's places that can be a lot cheaper than other places, as with Indonesia. Obviously some of the cities like New York and Los Angeles are very, very expensive, but you can find cheaper places in the countryside. But in general, it's very, very expensive. And for me, it just, I could have a better quality of life living in a place that's much more affordable. Other parts of Southeast Asia, even there's some cheaper parts in Europe or South America. And, it so happened that I've fallen in love with Indonesia, and that's where I am now. But, my feelings is that if you can live in a place that's much more affordable, your money could take you further, you can save more money and set up a better life for in the future and in retirement. And that's my feelings towards, wanting to go back to the US now. It's terribly, terribly expensive. And especially since like Corona inflation has gone up quite a bit. And you will see how expensive it is in one of the next videos coming out, where I went and met the Indonesians in Philadelphia and had some of the Indonesian food there. And you guys can see just how expensive cost of living is, food, rent, and whatnot. So yeah, that's my feelings on going back to the US for now. And the next question, I kind of organized questions to try to make sense. We're in a little bit of an American section of questions. From Instagram profile, Dharmastuti 888. What makes you proud to be an American? Good question. I wonder if this is an American or an Indonesian. I'm guessing it's an Indonesian. But yeah, I think for me, and what I always say is for me, what makes me proud to be an American is how diverse it is, and the fact that an American is not defined by their color of their skin, their race, their religion, or any of those things. Obviously in most other countries, there's a certain ethnicity of people that exist there. For the most part, people look relatively similar. A lot of people have the same religion. And these are a lot of characteristics that define a certain country. You know, like the example that people give is if you watch the Olympics gymnastics team, if you, you know, you watch the Chinese Olympics gymnastics teams, like the women, it's four Chinese women. If you watch the Italian women's gymnastics team, it's four Italian women. But if you look at the United States women's gymnastics team, there's an Asian woman, a black woman, a white woman, and a Hispanic woman. So I think that's really cool that, you know, that's what, you know, America is not represented by a certain race or ethnicity. It's a very, very diverse country. And I think it's cool of how diverse we are. I think it's cool of how many different people from around the world have moved here and have helped build this country. And obviously this is reflected on why I love to travel. And I just love experiencing new things and love meeting new people. So I think it's so cool that you can find so much here in the US. So with that being said, it's almost a gift and a curse, right? Because of how diverse we are. And how strong that makes us, it also causes a lot of tension and problems because people are so different, and some people aren't able to handle that, and some people, you know, may be prejudiced or racist towards certain ethnicities or groups. That definitely does exist. It can create a bit of tension. But I think although there may be a lot that you've seen in the news and media about how racist Americans are and how prejudiced it is, and I really think that if you ask your average American, you know, the majority of Americans think like I do, and, you know, they're proud of how diverse America is, and they think it's cool about how many people from around the world have come here and are here today and, you know, have helped build this country. So obviously we don't have the best past with certain things and with like slavery, and obviously America's definitely not perfect, but overall I think it's a good place, and that's my feelings on why I'm proud to be from here. Okay, next question from YouTube profile Sazai92, do you miss home, and are you sad you don't get to see your friends? So I'll be honest, when I'm on the road traveling, it's not often that I miss home. Whether I was in Indonesia or even my travels before Indonesia, it's not often that I miss home. I'm very content on the road. I'm very content as a nomad, and it's just not something I miss. I definitely do get nostalgic about things. I definitely will look back at my old photos and be like, man, I miss the times where I was living in San Diego in California, or man, I miss the times when I was a teenager in New York with my friends, or things like that. But it's not often that I miss home. But I will say, when I do come home, especially in the last 4 weeks, it makes me miss it. So it's kind of like when you're so removed from it and when you're so separated from it, it's hard to it doesn't cross your mind as much. But now that I'm here for 4 weeks, and now that I've seen my family, and now that I've seen my friends, and you kind of get a taste of all that, that definitely makes me a bit sad that I have to leave. So it's hard. Yeah, it's hard. You know, Indonesia is literally, is almost on the opposite side of the world as New York is pretty much on the opposite side of the world as Bali. So it's very, very far. But yeah, I love my family and friends. I appreciate them so much. It's times like these when I come home for a few weeks and see everyone that reminds me why I love this place and why I'm thankful that I grew up here, and thankful for my family and my friends and everyone that raised me. But it's hard. I just have this itch to get out and go see things, and it's just something that I've always wanted to do. So, you know, because I need to go, I want to go travel and I want to go see these things, I just have to sacrifice not being here. And it is what it is. That's what we say in English. It is what it is. I don't know if that, we've tried to translate that to Indonesian, but it would be like itu apa gitu, like that, or itu apa gitu, like that. So it is what it is, and you can't change it, so you just have to take it. But yeah, next one would be, yeah, okay, everyone asked about Shane and I's love life, a lot of personal questions about that, and yeah, I'll be honest with you guys and maybe talk a bit about our approach to the channel. But yeah, I think for Shane and I, one thing we're really trying to be good about is to make sure that our channel remains as a channel about our travels. You know, we're not trying to be lifestyle influencers. We're not trying to be these daily influencers that give you, you know, every single aspect of our personal life and private life and try to stir up drama and you know, relationship drama and stuff like that. It's just, that's not what we're trying to do. And we understand people do that, and we understand viewers are definitely very interested in some of our private and personal life, but we're trying to do a good job at keeping a barrier between those things. And it's just our decision to keep you know our personal life private, and we try to best to be keep our travel life as open and authentic with you guys as possible. So I watch content and I follow YouTubers and I follow Instagrammers, and of course I love when they're open and honest and they talk about their things that are good and they talk about things that are not as good, and it feels more authentic. And I understand that people want us to be as open as that, because I appreciate it as well when I watch content. But we're trying to do that through our travels. When we're traveling and when we're making videos while we're traveling, we want to be as open and authentic during those videos as we possibly can. Tell you how we're feeling, show you the highs, show you the lows, and be honest that way. But in terms of some things that are personal life, I think we're always going to do our best to kind of keep a wall between those things. So yeah, to be honest, I do have a girlfriend now. We met this past year and started dating this past year. I didn't have a girlfriend when I started The Lost Boys. And yeah, it's been really great, but I don't think you guys will ever meet her or ever see her on camera. it's also something that we've talked about, but that's just something that I want to remain private in my personal life. And I know a lot of people also have found our personal Instagrams, and I keep my personal Instagram private. So if I haven't accepted your request, I'm sorry. It's nothing mean, or I'm not trying to be mean or personal, but again, these are other things that I want to keep in my private life. And as far as my family and friends here in New York, I have shown a taste of them on Instagram stories and also in some of my videos I made from home last year, but I don't ever envision myself making a full video with all my friends and family here. So these are just kind of layers and walls that I want to have up to make sure that I keep my personal life private and not thrown out to the public, again, because going back to the first question, I'm not interested in attention in that regard. So yeah, that's a little bit about the personal life, the love life, and just a general kind of feel for what we're doing with our channel. Okay, next question from Instagram ThingSense. Is there a demand from Rob's family to stop traveling and to work permanently in America? Good question. No, there's not a demand for that from my family. There's not a demand from my friends. I wouldn't say that I have a ton of pressure from people at home that are saying, what are you doing? Why are you starting the YouTube channel? Or why are you just traveling all the world like crazy? I don't have a lot of pressure in the sense of people saying, no, you have to live this, traditional life where you have to stay in America and work a 9-to-5 corporate job and wear a suit to work every day and all that stuff. I don't have a lot of pressure in the sense of people saying, do this, do this, do this. But I think, like I've said in some other live streams, I've definitely come across some people that don't quite understand it. They might not understand, especially when I was getting out of the military. People don't understand, why are you choosing this path? Or especially after we started the channel, people didn't understand, how does this work? How do you make money? How do you do this as a business? And that's just because they're not, as into YouTube per se as I am, or as you are, if you watch YouTube. So yeah, I don't have a lot of pressure in saying like, come home, live this truly traditional life and be here. But I'd be lying if I said some people, they might not understand me, and that's totally fine. And I can honestly say that I'm very lucky in the support that I get from my family and friends, supporting me, happy with what I'm doing. And if I didn't have that, it would definitely be tougher to be traveling this much. It would definitely be tough to have start the channel and start this business. So I appreciate that. But I don't have much pressure. Yeah, my parent, my mom's not calling me every day and saying, get back to New York, get a job. And yeah, as long as things go well with the channel and we can create something sustainable and, make a career out of this and make a good living, my family and friends will support me. But if the channel wasn't successful, if Shane and I were just doing this and kind of not taking it seriously, then sure, I'm sure I would have some pressure. But Shane and I are taking this very seriously, and obviously we're here to make videos and we're here to entertain people, but we're also here to create a business and support ourselves, and we're doing the best we can. So yeah, no pressure to come back to the US, at least right now. If that changes, I'll let you guys know. Another question from Instagram, Aisa Tik Chusim. I don't know if they pronounce it with phonetically in Indonesian or phonetically in English. But yeah, she asks, or he asks, whoever this is, what is your main goal while traveling? So for me, main goal is to have new experiences and open up your mind. Someone asked a question later on, I'll answer towards the end, about what are the lessons you've learned and how you've changed. But yeah, for me, I think traveling is so important to get outside of your comfort zone, get out of the place where you've grown up and where you lived and kind of what nurtured and helped you, mature, and to go out to new places and to learn new things, to meet new people, to learn about different cultures, to see how people live their life and their philosophies and the decisions they make, and to take those in as best you can and to learn as much as you can and to use everything you've learned and grow as a person. That's what I really feel like. Because I think if you stay in the same place where you were raised, where you were born and where you were raised, and you never have that time to really go out and explore the world, I think you're kind of limiting yourself on how much you can grow as a person. And that's me personally. Now, I understand, that's very, I don't want to come off cocky and kind of sounding like an ass, because I know a lot of people aren't able to do that. A lot of people can't afford to travel. So obviously in that regard, I understand. And obviously I would never put pressure on somebody to travel that isn't able to do that, or, has a family young. So I totally understand and respect those people. But, I think there's a lot of people out in the world that do have the means to travel, that financially can do it, and they just never take that chance. So for me, that's my main goal while traveling. And I can honestly say that from all the areas of the world that I've traveled, I've been in America and Canada, I've been in Central America, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, and Southeast Asia. And I can say, in each of those places, I've learned different things and taken lessons from all those different regions and tried to combine those things into my approach to life. So an example would be, growing up in America, I learned about strong work ethic and learned about working hard and taking responsibility and taking initiative and putting yourself into a place and position where you want to be. You have ultimate control over your life and you can do that. So that's something, work ethic and initiative, that's kind of something I've learned from America. And I spent a lot of time in Europe. I've spent, 6+ months in Europe through different trips. I've interacted with a ton of Europeans, both in Europe and also around Southeast Asia, especially in Bali. And, I've learned a lot from them as to they're a lot better at balancing their life, in my opinion, a lot better than Americans. And they do a better job at managing, working hard, but also taking time off and enjoying their life. The big joke in America is that, Americans, if they're lucky, have 10 days off a year, maybe 2 weeks max. And Europeans have like months off a year that they could take and go on a take a vacation or travel. So I think Europeans do a great job at balancing that. And Europeans really know how to enjoy life and really know how to appreciate life and appreciate the little things and food and culture. And that's definitely something that I've taken away from them. And I also think partying in Europe is the best. I think Europeans know how to have the best time. I've gone to music festivals in all the places I've been, and I think that the music festivals in Europe are the best. It's just the best energy and vibe. So that's definitely something I've taken away from Europeans. And then, in Southeast Asia, something I've taken away is that is the sense of community that people have here in Indonesia and other parts of Southeast Asia that I've been. Also, I've taken away, just appreciating the little things and that you don't need much to be happy. Obviously, your average person in Southeast Asia doesn't have anything close to the amount of wealth and money and things that someone in America or Europe does. I mean, even like my house right here, my family is, middle class in America, very middle of the road. But this house, a 3-bedroom house is something that most Indonesians could not even fathom having. Yet most Indonesians or other people across Southeast Asia are still very, very happy. I've met people, that live in the kampung and live a very basic, rugged, bare bones lifestyle. And I've met people that live in the city that just have a little bit of space, that live in a really crowded area, and people all within that spectrum that are all happy, that don't have much. So that's definitely a lesson that I began to learn when I was younger, but it kind of was more confirmed, and I was able to take it in really wholeheartedly once I was in Southeast Asia, especially Indonesia, because I got to see it firsthand. So for me, taking all of those things you know, the feelings I have in America, the feelings I've had in Europe, and the feelings I've had in Southeast Asia, and putting those together and kind of approaching life like that, that's why I travel. So I hope eventually that I can get to, you know, the Middle East. I really want to go to Africa and just kind of see the people there and see what's going on there, see the culture and see the approach to life, and bring even more into my, you know, my worldview and philosophy on life. So that's why I travel. And then we'll do one more personal question until before we go into the questions about Indo. From YouTube channel La Fountain Media Productions 2176 for ask Shane and I, if I wasn't a YouTuber, I would be ... Good question. I don't know, man. It's hard to say because the way this all came about, the reason why I'm Indonesia, the reason why the channel was started is really because of Corona. If Corona did not happen, there's a very, very, very good chance that I would not be in Indonesia and that I would not have a YouTube channel. Because my plans were ultimately to travel Southeast Asia for 6 to 8 months. I had plans to visit Indonesia. I had plans to visit Bali and also maybe Sumatra or Java, but just on a 1 month visa. I was kind of doing 1 month in each country. And I don't know what my feelings would have been towards Indo towards then. Back then, I'm sure I would have loved it, but I don't know if I would have decided to move there. I probably would have never met Shane. And I don't know if I would have eventually started a YouTube channel. My initial plan was to take the gap year, travel, and then go back to graduate school and get a graduate degree and then get a job somewhere. I definitely had interest in teaching English in Asia or maybe going to get a work holiday visa in New Zealand or Australia before I kind of went to back to normal life, to grad school. But if I wasn't a YouTuber, I mean, I think this is not 100% what this would have happened, but there would have been a very good chance that I eventually would have traveled a bit more and I would have went back to the US, gotten my graduate degree, and become a project manager for big like engineering projects, big construction projects. So I studied civil engineering for my bachelor's, and I was planning on getting an MBA, so doing business for my master's, and then that would have made me a project manager for big scale projects like bridges or tunnels or buildings or something like that. So that very well could have happened, and I could have been probably in California. I wanted to live in California, so I wanted to go back to San Diego where I spent some time, get my graduate degree, and get a job there. So that, I think, is the most likely outcome if I wasn't a YouTuber. But there are many other things could have happened. But yeah, so that's good question, good question. But now we'll move on to some Indo questions about Indonesia. Just some simple ones and some other ones, and we'll go through those. So the first one was from YouTube channel Deans Austin 9661 asked, what's your favorite city in Indonesia? So, and then from Instagram profile, Dumprila asked, what is your favorite area in Indonesia? So I'm going to break those up. It's important to break those two up. So for cities in Indonesia, so we're just talking cities, I would have to say Jogjakarta is my favorite. It's just such a good vibe, man. I like university kind of young feeling cities where there's like a young energy there. There's a lot to do. Also because Jogja has the university city with a lot of arts and music, which is great. Jogja itself has a lot of history, as we know, which I think is really cool. The food is great there. I love sate klatak. Gudeg is not my favorite, but I'll eat it. But bakmi Jawa is so good. Some of the jajanan pasar they have there. I like some of the sweets. And so it's a good food scene as well. And there's a decent foreigner scene there, a bule scene there. In my opinion, it's a little bit nicer than Bali. It's a little bit more backpacker feel, more kind of chill vibe with foreigners there. There's not as many. They just have kind of like Pariwotaman is the street. I'm sure you guys know. That's in the south. That's kind of where the foreigners are. There's a few bars that they have live music, and it has a nice foreigner scene. So for me, it's like a balance of all those things. It's still a city. It's not too big. It's not huge, but there's still a lot of people, and there's still a lot going on. So Jogja is my favorite city. I haven't been back since we were filming there in 2021, but I've been there 3 times now. We were there before the channel as well. I have some good friends there. So yeah, I would say Jogja. Favorite area in Indonesia? I always said it, you know, before Sumatra, and people were asking us during Sumatra, And now that we've finished traveling Sumatra, I can still say that Flores is my favorite island, and specifically Bajawa in Flores is my favorite area. I love Sumatra, and obviously it's so big and there's so much you can see. It's huge, the diversity is insane. You know, 80 million people, all the different ethnic groups and food and whatnot, but I don't know. Flores still holds a special place in my heart. I love that the island still is fairly big, but there's only 2 million people. And the one road that you can drive across is just unbelievable. There's no traffic. There's no, you know, there's not huge cities with huge population densities. It's just kind of smaller sized areas around. And it's so freaking beautiful. And speaking about Bajawa, the specific area where we have in our old videos, it's just such a cool place. The people were amazing. And yeah, that's still my favorite area. So I need to get back there and see the family and friends we made there. It's been over 2 years now. We were there in October of 2021. So I'm actually thinking about going there when I get back to Bali this month. So I'm thinking about going to Bali for 2 weeks and then going to Flores just for a little bit before Shane and I start filming content again. So yeah, I have to say Flores. Love Sumatra, love Java, love Bali and everywhere else we've been. But yeah, I'm sorry, Flores is the spot. Instagram profile Fisky asked, which region do you think has the best coffee? He asked in Sumatra. My opinion, obviously, I think Sumatra has the best coffee. The best coffee I've had was in Lampung and Aceh, but Kopi Gayo, guys, Kopi Gayo from Aceh is on freaking believable. It's so good. I can't explain to you how good it was. I'm sure you've already seen in our content the videos we made there, but it's so freaking good. They have the Kopi Arabica, so the Arabica beans. And they do it similar to the way the Vietnamese do it, but they do the strong black coffee and then they do a little bit of kental manis, the condensed milk. So the balance between the strong bitterness of the Arabica coffee and then, you know, the sweet condensed milk is so good. So I'm going to have to say Kopi Gayo from Takengon Aceh would be my favorite coffee. YouTube channel Tetap Samangat 6344. During your 3 years living in Indonesia, what was the most annoying thing experienced and how did you overcome it? To be honest, yeah, towards the end of the time in Sumatra, it was just tough dealing with Minang and Batak people because they're so friendly. And I'm not saying, I guess, they're not annoying, but this began to become annoying for us because they're just, everyone immediately comes to talk to you, man. And after we were on the road for 4, 5, 6 months and constantly getting approached by people, everyone, for the most part, asks the same questions. Everyone asks, you know, where are you from? Why are you here? Are you married? Why aren't you married? What hotel are you staying at? And it's just the same questions. And it's like I was saying earlier, it's just the people in Sumatra are a lot more direct and they come straight up to you. So it was, our patience was running out towards the end of the trip in Sumatra. And it was just tough. So, you know, I think maybe I wasn't always the nicest person in some of those situations. I tried my best to, you know, be friendly and talk to people, but, you know, sometimes I just avoided going out to super public places, or I tried to avoid some conversations. I just, you know, I want to go get food and go back to the guest house, or I just want to go to the convenience store and get a snack and go back to the guest house. But yeah, I mean, how do we overcome it? Is just trying to be as patient as possible. But it was tough. It was tough, I'll admit. Instagram profile Ariof asked, how do you see the potential of tourism of Indonesia, especially Sumatra? So this is tough, man. And if I were to compare Indonesia to the other Southeast Asian countries, it's just very, very different. The other Southeast Asian countries, specifically the peninsula, so Thailand, Laos, Vietnam, Cambodia, it's just a lot better built for traveling, especially for backpackers. Because in those places, there's a very, you know, standard route that you take around each of the countries. It makes sense. It's almost like a circle and you can go around clockwise or you can go around counterclockwise. Along that route, there's tons and tons of hostels and cheap places to stay, which makes it very easy for people to travel to. And if you want more, you know, luxurious, you know, accommodation, there's that as well. So in Indonesia, I'll be honest, it's not, right now, it's not really catered to travelers unless you're a very, very raw, off the beaten path type of traveler. There's certain regions that are more catered. Obviously, Bali is the number one and it will remain like that forever. Now people are starting to venture into East Java. A lot of people will leave Bali. They'll come to East Java, do Ijen, Ayutthaya Mandi Karipura, Bromo, Tampak Sewu, and that is kind of getting built up. There's more places to stay. The trains are there. It's a bit easier. And then obviously Komodo is a big place people are going, and even parts of Sumatra, as you guys saw. Some people are traveling to West Sumatra. They come to Padang and they do a few different things in the area, or they fly to Medan and they do a few different things in the area. But in terms of Indonesia as a country, it's quite difficult to travel. So I think the potential is out there and the potential is huge. It's just a matter of how Indonesia, how the people and how the government want to take this on. I think the statistic is that the percentage of GDP of Indonesia that accounts for tourism is less than 5%. And the percentage of that within that's foreigners is so small. Like the majority of that 5% of GDP for tourism is mostly domestic tourism travelers, so who approach traveling a lot differently than a foreigner would. So it might not be in Indonesia's primary interest to do tourism, as in a place like Thailand or somewhere else where tourism accounts for a huge percentage of their, you know, economic growth. So yeah, it all depends on what you guys, how Indonesia approaches it. I think the potential is there, especially in Sumatra, especially in Java, especially in Bali, obviously in Bali. It just depends on what people have to do. But, you know, I definitely have to increase some infrastructure, some roads. The trains are great in Java. I don't know, a lot of people travel by train. And then just increasing all forms of accommodation from luxury places down to backpacker, hostel-style cheap places. So I think the potential is there, but we'll see what pans out. This is a good question from Instagram, Oki World. If you could start over your time in Indo, how would you do it differently? So this is tough because we were there during Corona. So we were kind of just chilling in Bali from March 2020 until August 2020. And then when Indonesia opened up for traveling between islands with Corona tests, we started traveling to different islands. I think we did there's not much I would change, I'll be honest. I think we did it was sick. Like, we had such a good time. We just did motorbike trips with, you know, little 125 automatic scooters. That's how we used to travel, and even before YouTube. And we hit Lombok and Sumbawa on a trip for a couple months. We hit East Java on a trip for a couple months. Then we went all the way out to Jogja and Central Java on a trip. So I think we did Indo right. If I could do anything differently, I think I try to learn Bahasa Indonesia. I try to learn Indonesian earlier. I didn't really try to learn until we started YouTube. So I didn't really start learning until September 2021. So it's been just over 2 years. And I imagine if I had started learning right when I got to Indonesia in March 2020, I'd be a lot more fluent. And once you speak the local language, it takes your travels to a whole different level. So if I could do anything differently, I'd go back and learn Indonesian. That being said, it's hard when you're in Bali because everyone speaks English. And even now when I go back there and I try to do all my daily communication, if I'm filling up, you know, bensin, petrol, if I go to the mini mart, if I go to a restaurant or whatever, I try to speak Indonesian. And a lot of times people, you know, half the time we speak Indonesian, half the time people just want to speak English. So it's hard to learn in Bali. But if I do anything differently, I would try to learn Indonesian as soon as I got there. YouTube profile, Arishadi SS9SI asks, will you stay in Indonesia forever or return home? Like I said before, I don't know. You know, I say my 3 to 5 year plan is I will most likely be in Indonesia at some point throughout the year, especially in Bali, as my home base. But it's hard to say. I don't know. I could be there forever, or I could come back to the US, or I could live somewhere else. So I don't know, but a lot of people do ask if Shane and I would ever change our citizenship to Indonesia, and I'll be straight up, that's never gonna happen. I'm never gonna give up a US passport. It would just, the Indonesian passport, as we all know, is not as strong as the US passport. I would never give up, and in Indonesia, the rule is that you can't have dual citizenship. So if you're a citizen of Indonesia, you're not allowed to be a citizen of another country. And that's kind of rare. A lot of other countries allow you to do that. America allows you to do that. So if I'm an American citizen and I have an American passport, I'm allowed to get a passport and be a citizen of another country and have dual citizenship. And there's many countries in Europe that do that as well. So I know there's a push for Indonesia to change that rule. If Indonesia did change the rule and I could be an Indonesian citizen and an American citizen, then I'd probably do it. But if I would have to change to an Indonesian citizen and give up my American passport, I would not do that. So I know a lot of people ask about that. And then Instagram, Tuan Mudarizal. Answer honestly, which is the best country in Southeast Asia in your opinion? Okay, so I've said I've been to Thailand, Laos, Vietnam, and Indonesia. It's so hard to say which is the best country, so I'm not going to tell you which one's the best. I mean, I will tell you that Indonesia is my favorite. Indonesia is my it's probably my favorite country along with New Zealand. New Zealand is, I think, is just because of the nature is unreal. But for me to say Indonesia is my favorite country in Southeast Asia, I couldn't tell you it's the best. Again, I think it depends what you're looking for and what you want to do. So, you know, Indonesia offers a lot, obviously, and there's some things that Thailand may offer that Indonesia doesn't. And there may be some things that Vietnam offers that Indonesia doesn't. So it depends what you're looking for. But, you know, as a whole with... like in Indonesia, the things you're probably looking for are, you know, a very diverse food options because of all the different types of food. Indonesia has some of the best diving in the world, and Komodo, Raja Ampat, and Sulawesi, and Sumatra. Indonesia has some of the best surfing in the world. Indonesia probably has some of the best beaches in the world, some of the best trekking in the world. So some of the most interesting culture, you know, if you're looking for variety in culture, there's all these different things. So if those are the top of your like priority list, then of course Indonesia is going to be your place to go. But you know, maybe you're looking for different things that Vietnam might offer to you, or that Thailand might offer to you. You know, Thailand has the whole Buddhist, you know, they're all Buddhist. So if you're looking to visit Buddhist temples and learn about, you know, philosophy and Buddhism, then obviously we know there's some of that in Indonesia, but you're probably better off going to Thailand to find that. There's some places in Vietnam that I've been, specifically one place called the Hajang Loop that is probably one of the most prettiest places I've ever been in my entire life. And you may not be able to find that in Indonesia. So there's certain things that will, depending on what you're looking for, you know, another country might offer to you. So I wouldn't say Indonesia is the best, but I would tell you that Indonesia is my favorite country in Southeast Asia. Okay, so now we've got some serious questions. And then there's a kind of like some deep reflecting questions, and then we'll just wrap up and tell you what's coming up ahead. So from Instagram profile, Sharapov, is there any significant changes from your point of view or behavior after 6 months road trip? Yes. In terms of being on the road, I kind of alluded to it before, but we were just so tired and, you know, maybe our patience ran out a bit because we were just, for the most part, just dealing with kind of the same things over and over. Obviously, you know, Sumatra is very different. There's a lot of diversity between provinces, but we were tired, you know, especially the 6th, 7th month on the road. So as far as our behavior, yeah, obviously I don't think we were as, maybe not as engaged in the trip. We weren't as motivated. You know, we didn't do it as much in Aceh as I would have liked, but at that point we were just trying to finish the trip within 8 months just to have some time off in Bali before coming home. So yeah, you know, if we had maybe gone north to south, if we had started in Aceh and gone south, maybe we would have done more in Aceh and North Sumatra. But yeah, things definitely changed. Our point of views definitely changed about traveling for that long. I'm sure we talked about it in the live stream, but you know, we'll never probably travel for that long again. I mean, we did 8 months and we did 2 months, a 2 week break, 2 months, a 2 week break, and then we did 4 months straight. And I don't think you'll ever see us do that again. It's not sustainable. It was quite tough mentally. It was quite tough physically. And we're going to try to get to a better balanced schedule where we kind of do however much time we do on, we do the same amount of time off. So if we do 1 month or 2 months on traveling, then we'll take 1 month or 2 months off. So that's definitely something we learned, you know, doing that long of a trip. And in the future, I think you'll see us do that in the future as well. And then the next question is from Instagram, Fami Bors. What made you never back out of the journey? What is the motivation? I think it was just because we set the, I'm guessing this question refers specifically to Sumatra. I mean, if we talk specifically about Sumatra, you know, we set the goal. We're driving from Jakarta to Sabang. This is what we're going to do. We're going to finish it. We told people we're doing that. We committed to it up front. We put it in the intro of every video. You know, join us on our journey as we're driving from Jakarta to Sabang. So, you know, the motivation was that we're going to finish this trip, and that's what we're here to do. So it was kind of just, you know, the biggest motivation was that we committed to this and we have to finish it. Like, we can't just stop and end it. And then if you're talking in general about, you know, why you never back down from the journey, I guess of YouTube and traveling, it's, yeah, I mean, we, you know, there's obviously highs and lows doing this. But the biggest motivation would be being able to be self, you know, a small business with just Shane and I, and we don't have to work for anybody. We don't ever have to have a boss. We can make our own schedule. We can do things the way we want to do them. And we can work hard and be successful that way, you know, by traveling, making the content like this. And that's probably the biggest motivation, you know, that keeps us doing this and that keeps us along this journey. Because I don't want to go back to working in the military, and I don't want to go back to a normal 9-to-5. That's not what I want to do. So, you know, as many highs and lows as there are, as many ups and downs as there are, the biggest motivation would, you know, definitely be that, is that, you know, we can create something and build something successful ourselves. And that's the, you know, that's the dream, and that's what we're trying to do. And slowly but surely, we're making our way there. Okay, from Instagram, Mutia Harliza, what did you learn from such a long trip? So kind of reflecting, yeah, similar to the 6 months on the road, but yeah, kind of what I said before. We need to be better about being more balanced on our future trips. So, I'll be honest, I don't think you're ever going to see us, at least with the bigger islands, you know, like Kalimantan and Sulawesi and Papua. I don't think you're ever going to see us decide to say, hey, all right, we're going to Kalimantan. We're going to travel the whole entire island, and however long it takes us, that's what the way it's going to be. I don't think you're going to see that from us anymore. It's just, and I can get into it. There's a few reasons why, but you know, the one thing is that it wouldn't be very sustainable to do that. And if we were to travel Sumatra again, we wouldn't do the same thing we just did. We wouldn't say, hey, we're driving our bikes from Jakarta to Sabang, and we're going to try to cover every inch in between. You're not going to see us do that again, because one, it's just not sustainable to do that. On our bodies, on our minds, in terms of a balanced work life routine, it's just too much to do it that way. The second is that it's really not smart for our business to do that way. And, you know, the reason is while we're doing these entire long road trips, it's hard for us to close deals and find sponsorships on our videos, while we're in the middle of a road trip. And like we've said multiple times, the YouTube revenue that we make specifically from, you know, Indonesian views and our channel's 90% Indonesian audience is not very high. And a lot of people think, like, we constantly refute this, that bules and foreigners make content in Indonesia to earn money, and we try to tell you guys that it's not the case. So, you know, we did get to a point for a couple months where our YouTube earnings actually covered Shane's and Isaac's expenses, but it was only on the months where our content went super viral, when those videos all had a million views, like the Blue Lake, Danau Kacho, Gunung Kerinci, and then the Independence Day video, all those videos that hit, you know, over a million views. And when we went trending, it was those during those months where our YouTube revenue actually covered our expenses. But besides those months, even after that, our YouTube revenue does not cover our expenses from an Indonesian audience. So it doesn't really make sense business-wise to just long-term travel Indonesia when it's hard to close sponsorships and brand deals and only rely on YouTube AdSense revenue. Because yeah, to do a trip like we just did, like 7.5 months on the road, and to think about, you know, the revenue we made from that, it doesn't really equal out. And that's not to say that it wasn't a great experience, that we didn't learn a lot, and that I didn't have it like amazing times and didn't enjoy traveling. But at the end of the day, guys, Shane and I are trying to run a business and trying to earn money. You know, if I was sitting on a bank account with thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars or hundreds of thousands of dollars and I didn't have to worry about income, then I would travel Indonesia indefinitely and that would be great. But, you know, we do have to worry about that and think about that. So in the future, you know, it makes more sense for us to do shorter trips So if we say, you know, if we go to Kalimantan in the future, we might say, hey, you know, we're gonna explore West Kalimantan for 2 months. We're gonna go to West Kalimantan. We're gonna explore a couple of the cities. We're gonna go visit the Dayak tribes. We're gonna go to these places, and then after that, we're finished. And then we're gonna come back to Bali and probably take 2 months off and chill. And during, we'll have a bunch of content that we can edit and post. And then after that, you know, we might say, all right, we're going 2 months to, you know, North Sulawesi. We're going to go to Manado. We're going to spend some time in Manado. We're going to go to Bunikan, do some diving, drive around a little bit and explore. And then after that, we'll come back to Bali and take another time off. So I think, and then if we do that, we can find sponsorships for individual trips. We can pitch sponsors and say, hey, we're doing this trip. This is what the schedule is going to be. This is what the video is going to be. Do you want to sponsor us? So that makes it easier for us and makes it better for us from a business perspective, and also from a longevity of your body and maintenance perspective. And then, the other thing was that I forgot to talk about in the beginning, but that, yeah, you'll probably see us doing trips outside of Indonesia next year. You know, we've been saying it for so long, but we do think it's important to build an international audience. We want to be an international channel. So I think we're going to try to integrate trips outside of Indonesia with trips in Indonesia. So next year, maybe we do a couple months traveling outside of Indonesia. We come take some time off. Then we make some content in Indonesia. And then we go outside of Indonesia. So I think that's what you'll see from us for the future. It'll be a lot better for us physically, mentally, so we don't burn out. It will be better for our business. And these are some of the things that we really learned from the last year in Sumatra, because we were there for so long and on the road for so long. So a lot of lessons learned this year for sure. And then Instagram, Zulkifli Abdulgani, I'm sorry if I'm butchering names, asked, what is the most valuable life lesson you've learned along the journey? So I'm gonna take this in for all of the, my whole journey, I guess. Biggest life lesson is that, you know, just because you don't understand somebody, just because the way they live their life or the decisions that they make don't make sense to you, doesn't mean that they're a bad person. It doesn't mean that they're an ill-intended person or that they're an evil person. And I think that's a big problem with the world today, is that people see others that are different from them, you know, sometimes whether they look different, whether their religion or their belief system is different, sometimes, you know, their culture and all these things. And they see someone acting like that, or they see someone like that, and they automatically think that that's a bad person. Now, obviously, in certain cases, if you're talking about someone that's inherently racist or inherently prejudiced or has very, very, you know, bad and ugly views about the world and tries to harm people, of course, you know, I would say that those people are evil. But I think there's a lot of misconception and confusion between everyday people just because, you know, someone believes something different than you, or acts different than you, or eats different than you, or looks different than you, that some people get caught up in that and that they think that it's a bad person. And I think that's driven by how connected the world is with social media, and it's driven by the news, and it's driven by the media, and it's not a good thing, and it's not conducive to us as human beings. And the reason I've learned that is because I've interacted with so many different people. You know, through my time in the military in the U.S., I've lived all around the U.S. I've traveled to many, many states in the U.S., and I got to learn about Americans in different parts of the U.S., in the countryside, on the farms, in the cities, all the different ethnicities and groups. And I never, you know, obviously there's bad people out there, but I just think the majority of people are not bad, ill-intended people. And there's just, you know, especially in America, there's so much combativeness because people don't understand each other. And then if you take that on a global scale, a global perspective, it's the same thing. I've been to many different countries and spoken to so many different people, and most people I spoke with are great. And just because someone does something differently or looks differently, it doesn't necessarily mean they're a bad person. It's just people are, you know, apprehensive to sit at the table, figuratively speaking, and have the conversation with somebody just because they look different or they think differently. And I just really think that's not the case. And that's one of the biggest things I've learned. So You know, and that happens all over. You know, that's happened. It doesn't matter where you're from or which part of the world you're in. This is how some people act, and it's unfortunate, but it is what it is. But it's a lesson that I've learned, and I think it's probably the most important lesson that I've learned. And hopefully more people can learn it. And that's why I think travel is so important, because if you're able to travel, that's a lesson that you can learn quickly. You know, that's a lesson that you can learn quickly and have experience in meeting new people and having those conversations. So that's probably the most important lesson I've learned along the journey. Instagram profile Digis, how do you feel about being a citizen of the world, and how do you see yourself compared to a few years back? I like that. So I learned this term not long ago from one of my other friends, who's from Algeria in Africa, actually, and he's a world traveler as well, and he always refers to himself as a citizen of the world. I never really heard that until last year, so I guess I'm a citizen of the world. But one, I would say that I'm very fortunate and lucky to be in that case and in that situation, because I know not everyone is able to do that. And you know, how do I feel about that, especially a few years back? Is, yeah, I'm a completely different person, man, from when, I mean, like I've said, it's just how much you grow and change. From when I lived on Long Island in New York for 18 years, and then after I left New York and then lived in California and lived in Florida, the amount of growth I had during and that time was astronomical. Like, I changed so much just getting out of my, you know, hometown. And then when I left America at 27 and I traveled around the world, and now even just, and then just always being around travelers, even in Bali, always being around international people, I've grown even more, you know, exponentially. And like I've said, it just changes your view of people, and it changes your worldview and your understanding of the world and culture. And yeah, I can honestly say that if you compare me now to me at 27 before, you know, we're talking two completely different people. If you compared me at 18, still in New York, after leaving New York and living around the US, two completely different people. So yeah, I'm grateful for that. And I wish everyone had the opportunity to do that. Obviously not everyone does, but you know, given how connected the world is via social media, there are some pros and benefits to social media, pros and cons of social media, but given how connected the world is, you know, hopefully people can have a better understanding of each other. But yeah, it's pretty wild having left here, especially coming back now. It's pretty nuts. To New York. From YouTube channel Hour00 Sunflower. Hi guys, what is the most meaningful thing for all of you from the Lost Boys channel? I mean, honestly, the most meaningful thing is you guys. Shane and I can't tell you how appreciative we are of you guys. Everyone who sends in really nice DMs and everyone who sends really nice comments and is supportive of us, we appreciate it so much. And it's, I don't think it was something personally that I thought about much before we started this. I didn't realize the community that we would build. I didn't realize the support we would get, especially from Indonesians who supported us, who supported our journey, who were positively reinforcing and kept us in good spirits. I don't think it's something that crossed my mind before we started the channel. And it's so cool to see what we built, especially because, like we've said before, Shane and I were essentially, we were doing this before we started YouTube. We were just doing it without cameras. You know, we were in Bali from 2020 until, you know, 2021, when we, end of 2021, when we started this channel. You know, we were in Bali, and we were often, when we were not in Bali, we've taken a lot of trips to other parts of Indonesia, and we were traveling around my motorbike, and we were going to waterfalls, and we were going to temples, and we're going to mosques, and we were eating different food, and we were doing all these, everything that we're doing now, we were doing before. It's just now that we've added this component of filming it and posting it, and it's crazy that, you know, it from our first year and a half in Indonesia, what was happening, and to now having this many subscribers, this many followers, and this many people are supporting us. And it's really not, for me, it's not about the numbers. Like, I don't give a shit about what the number says to Lost. If it's 300, whatever, 1,000, like, I really don't care. I really don't care what the number says next to the followers on Instagram. It's, obviously, it is important, but it's by no means my driving motivation. It's not all, you know, I care about, you know, equally care about, you know, growing a successful business with Shane and making sure that we're healthy and happy and okay. And I and 50-50 equally care about making really good videos to have a good impact on people and building this community. That's what I care about. So that's the most meaningful thing is you guys, for sure. So thank you for being part of this. And it's pretty wild to see where we're at, having only really done this for just over 2 years. So it's pretty cool. Okay, two more questions from Instagram. Ipriana, reflection from 2023. So yeah, so many lessons learned. So many lessons learned. Lessons learned individually as a person, lessons learned as a content creator, lessons learned as a trying to build a business, lessons learned as a citizen of the world. Yeah, I mean, I think, yeah, being in Sumatra for that long, being on the road for that long, hitting some highs and lows, hitting burnout at the end and being burned out from it, just so many things learned. I think one of the biggest reflections for me was that this past year felt like the first year I really lived in Southeast Asia, because, you know, a lot of foreigners say they live in Asia or Southeast Asia when they live in Bali, or they live in Phuket, or they live in Phuket, Thailand, or they live in Siargao in the Philippines, or they live in these kind of, you know, expat hubs where all the foreigners live. And it's kind of like a mix between, all right, like you're in Bali, but you're really not. And most of our time was spent in Bali, obviously. And we did do a lot of traveling around Java, and we were out east before as well. But, you know, this year we were boots on the ground in Sumatra for almost 8 months, fully immersed in the culture, you know, pretty much as deep as you can get, you know, speaking Indonesian, operating on a complete, you know, in this Indonesian world, completely separate from where we're from and what we're used to. And so I could say that this really felt like the first year I lived in Southeast Asia. So it felt like the first year where I was completely out of my comfort zone and thrown into this place and forced to adapt and live life. And I think that's, yeah, I don't, obviously not many people do that around the world. I mean, I'm sure there's a good bit of people do, but not many people do that. It's hard. It's very challenging at times. It's not easy. It definitely changed my view. It changed my view a little bit about Indonesia. I still think Indonesia is a great place, but now being immersed in it so much, I can definitely see the pros and cons. As to before, you know, we just live in Bali, we go out to a certain place and come home, and it was mostly just, oh yeah, we love Indonesia, Indonesia is the greatest place, and we talk about that in our live streams, but we're trying to be more honest. And this year definitely gave me a more balanced perspective about Indonesia and what I think the pros are and what I think the cons are, as with any country. And yeah, just the general reflection from 2023 it was wild just being fully immersed in it for, you know, 8 months out of the year. And just being like straight up in Sumatra, man. I don't think it's something many people do. It's not a usual experience to be, it's a very unordinary experience to be thrown into something like that. And it was tough, but we learned a lot, and I'm glad we finished the trip, and I'm glad of all the lessons we've taken away individually, together, and for the channel. And it was a crazy year, man. It was a crazy year. And then the final question from Instagram, Dora Pohan, is what's your goal for 2024? So yeah, Shane and I have obviously talked about what our plans for next year, what we want to do with this channel, and I think this is a really important year for us. I think this is really the year where we're going to branch out of Indonesia and try to build Lost Boys as an internationally recognized channel. I think obviously we're so grateful for our travels in Indonesia, all the places we've been. Like I said, we're incredibly grateful for the audience that we built and the community that we built, but we don't want to limit ourselves to just Indonesia. There's definitely some motivation that, you know, we want to be one of the best travel channels on YouTube. We want to make some of the best travel content that's on YouTube, and we want our videos to be watched by people all over the world. And again, that's not because I care about being famous on YouTube or care about the number of our subscribers going up, or I really don't care about any of that stuff. I just want to make really, really good videos and really good travel content, have a positive impact on as many people as we can, and you know, show people what travel can be. I want to tell, you know, show places and tell stories about people that you may have not have heard of before. And, you know, we want to be, you know, up there with some of the best content on YouTube. And that's what we want to do. And it's going to be, you know, when we make the step this year, it's going to be a big jump just because, you know, we've done a lot in Indonesia, but it's been to some extent, obviously we go to a lot of crazy places and we do a lot of wild things that most people don't do, but it's still within the bounds of Indonesia where we can speak the language, we can get by, it still feels, you know, fairly comfortable. So it's time for us to, you know, take a shot, probably get out of Indonesia and try to build ourselves as an international channel and try to grow our business. So that's the biggest goal for 2024. But before we do that, we're going to be chilling in Bali for a bit because it was a long year traveling. So yes, that's going to wrap up all the questions I have. What's to come? What's in the future? So I've got a video from Philadelphia. As I said before, Philadelphia is one of the cities not far from here in New York. It's about a couple hours south, and there's quite a big Indonesian population there. There's 10,000 people there. So I went down there. I linked up with some folks, and we went around and tried the food, met some of the Indonesians, and showed you guys around there. So I've got a video from there. Shane's got some videos from Hawaii, as you guys are going to see. And yes, I fly back to Bali tomorrow. Shane and I, we're going to get back together in a few weeks. We're going to be hitting Jakarta for a meetup, ideally. Do some podcasts and stuff there, which may have already happened before this video was posted. And then, yeah, like I said, we're gonna chill in Bali for a few months. So we're going to take a few months off from the road. We're going to be making some content in Bali. I know that some people may not like that. I know some of the Indonesians don't want to see content from Bali. They just want to see content from other parts of Indonesia. But it is what it is. We're going to do our best to make good videos in Bali while we're there for the next 3, 4, 5 months to show you guys stuff that you haven't seen before, to make unique content. And yes, to try to grow our audience bigger, eventually trying to build an international audience. So that's our plan for 2024. Again, I just want to give a huge shout out and thanks to all you guys. Thank you so much for watching, for liking, for commenting. It means a lot to us, whether you have been here since our first video in 2021 or you just joined us towards the end of our content in Sumatra. We appreciate you guys so much. I've said this before, but you know, I consume a lot of content. I watch a lot of people, and there's a lot of people on YouTube that are part of my daily life that, you know, I appreciate. And I'm not a big commenter. I've never commented on any single YouTube video that I've watched. I don't comment. So I know there's a lot of people out there that are like me that don't comment. So, you know, whether you comment or not, I just want to say that I appreciate you watching us and supporting us. It means so much. And I'm happy that we're able to be a part of your life every week. You set aside the time to watch our videos every week and keep up with us. It means so much. So thanks again, everybody, so much. Thanks for watching this video. If you watched the whole thing, that's amazing. Got you for about a little over an hour here. And the next time I will see you will be in Indonesia. So take care.